is the Thriving Dentist Show with Gary Takas, where we help you develop your ideal dental practice, one that provides personal, professional, and financial satisfaction.
Welcome to another edition of the Thriving Dentist Show. I'm Gary Takas, your show host. Very excited to have a friend on the show, Todd Snyder. Hey, Todd, how are you?
Doing well, Gary. Thanks for having me on the show.
Well, listen, you had a busy day today, but very excited that you could bring your wisdom to our listeners. And, you know, we had a chance to spend some time together recently up in Oregon. That was kind of fun, wasn't it?
Oh, that was amazing. Beautiful country and just in time for the wine festival.
Hey, it was kind of a collision of perfect opportunities. And then we just missed each other in Utah. We were about a week apart. But I was with you in spirit when you were wake surfing there in Utah. That was kind of fun, huh?
Oh, thanks. That was a great time. I was very happy that I could get out there and have a wonderful board meeting.
Yeah, a board meeting. That's my favorite kind of board meeting.
Exactly.
Well, guys,
you get to do more of those probably than I.
Well, not as much as I'd like. But hey, if you haven't figured this out already, Todd and I share a number of common interests. So at least three, but probably many more. So Todd, can I rattle off the three interests that we share?
Please do.
How about this amazing dental profession that we're in?
Amazing. Yeah. Amazing doesn't begin to describe it. It's phenomenal. It's the gateway to allow us to do what we get to do.
Exactly. So if you haven't figured this out already, Todd and I are passionate about this profession. And if you're listening to this, so are you. Secondly, Todd likes to race cars. Let's talk about that. We'll talk about that in this interview, won't we?
I certainly will. I'm always happy to talk about that. I hope your podcasters are taking a nice long flight or have got, you know, a couple hundred sets to do. And yeah.
Hey, there's no time limit on this interview. We can talk about it as much as we want. But
I look forward to it.
In all seriousness, one of the things I love about Todd is the way he's able to live a life combining his interests and hobbies and pursuit. And hey, getting on a racetrack and racing cars is one of those things. I happen to share that interest. And we'll talk a little bit about racing. And we have a number of listeners that also have some passion around you know, going fast around a track. So
that's great. Well, maybe they can come join us out of the track soon.
Let's do it.
All right.
And then, you know, surfing. How about that? You know, we have a common interest in board meetings, as in surfboard meetings.
So. That's right. That's right. Who knew?
Hey, just to kind of knock the top off our subject, we're going to talk about a fun topic tying in kind of the metaphor of racing. And we're going to talk about getting to the finish line. Kind of cool, huh?
I enjoy it. It's one of my favorite lectures. You know, it's amazing how I can tie in one of my passions being the racing aspect and the other passion of, you know, doing great work for my patients and feeling good about what you're doing for someone. And so the accuracy, the consistency, and the speed that is encompassed into racing has many overlaps and relationships with the dental practice. And that's kind of where I got the whole concept for that lecture.
You know, the metaphor actually is very appropriate. There's many different extensions of that metaphor that we can apply, can't we?
Oh, certainly. Yeah. And again, we've got plenty of time to talk about many of them.
Well, listen, I know that many of our listeners know who you are, but in case any of our listeners have been, you know, hiding under a rock and they don't know who you are, can I take a minute and share a little bit of your background? And would you keep me honest? Make sure I tell the truth.
You'll probably, if you don't hear from me, it means I'm blushing over here.
Well, and
I'm very modest.
And I'm only going to give the Reader's Digest condensed version, because if I was going to give the full version, the entire podcast would be your credentials.
But, no one would listen.
I do want to start. Todd is a practicing dentist in Southern California, in Laguna Niguel, which is a fun Orange County suburb. UCLA grad.
Bruins.
Yeah, go Bruins. Dr. Hornburg, I think you were a little bit after Dr. Hornburg, David.
I was.
You and David represent UCLA well.
Thank you.
Yeah, so Todd's a practicing dentist, and you know, that's one of the parts of his credentials that I want to emphasize. Although he's also an international lecturer, you've had the privilege of lecturing not only here in the United States, but all over the world. That's kind of cool. Also done quite a bit of writing. You're an international author as well, written in journals all over. Accredited by the AACD. When did you earn your accreditation?
2011.
Very cool. By the way, if as a listener, If you're thinking about peeking under the tent and getting involved with the AACD, I would strongly encourage you to do that at whatever level you're interested in. You may want to be just a member, which is fantastic. Go out to their annual meeting every year. I'd encourage you to step it up and work on becoming accredited. Todd, we didn't talk about this, but what do you think about that? Is that a useful pursuit?
Phenomenal pursuit. It really changes your perception of, you know, what you can offer to your patients, and the road to getting there is, you know, it's a lot of fun. It's challenging, but I think when you get to the other side, it's amazing to look back on. And I think your whole practice and your whole mindset changes. And I think that's a wonderful thing in today's, you know, running a dental business. I think it's something very important. Well, so I highly recommend it.
You know, I completely agree. And going to the annual meeting gives you a chance to rub shoulders with, you know, experts in the field of cosmetic dentistry and vendors that have great products. And, you know, it's one of my favorite meetings every year.
Agreed.
Hey, what else would you like to share with our listeners about your background, Todd? So I kind of hit some of the highlights, but what else is important for them to know?
Goodness.
Put you on the spot.
Yeah. Okay. So I love the business of dentistry and what it's allowed me to do to open doors into other businesses. It allows me the free time to, you know, spend time with my family, to create my own, my own schedule so that I can pursue, you know, car racing, surfing, biking, board meetings, you know, anything I want to do. I mean, dentistry is the golden key that opened the door to allow us to do this. And everyone can do the same thing. Whatever your passion is in this world, you know, obviously dentistry can open that door for you. With the right tools, you can certainly accomplish anything.
Well said. You know, I had a mutual friend of ours on the show, Tarun Agarwal. I know you know T-Bone.
Yeah.
And I asked T-Bone what he wanted to talk about. And he said, I want to talk about how dentistry can provide you with everything you want.
Yes.
And I just thought that was such a perfect topic. You know, dentistry can provide you with everything you want.
I agree wholeheartedly. Definitely.
And I'll tell you what, pardon my enthusiasm around this, but I happen to think this is a fantastic time to be in the dental profession. I don't mean to stick my head in the sand and pretend there aren't challenges. There's challenges in our profession, like there always have been. However, there's never been a better time to help your patients have great oral health and a gorgeous smile. And Todd, I know you literally that's the concept that emanates from every, you know, every cell in your body.
Definitely. Yeah. You know, it's all about taking care of the patients, and, we have so many minimally invasive means of helping them nowadays so that hopefully they have less, less visits to the dentist, less, you know, invasive therapy. And at the same time, we can do all kinds of fun stuff for them to make them look good and feel good with all the different cosmetic, orthodontic and, you know, veneers and bonding. There's so many wonderful things we can do for people. It's just a lot of fun to do dentistry.
Yeah. Hey, let's dive into this topic of getting to the finish line. I'll let you lead off with it, but where do you want to start with that? So the metaphor is getting to the finish line. And, you know, I think probably every one of our listeners can have their own finish line, right?
Definitely.
I mean, it's self-defined, right?
You got it.
So talk a little bit about what that means to you and some cool things you're doing in your practice to get you to the finish line.
Okay. So the whole metaphor came from obviously me having driven race cars for many years. And for me, the finish line was, you know, getting to a professional level. And then once getting at a professional level, being able to, you know, finish the race and get on the podium. And so the dental office is no different. You know, you start off green, wet behind the ears, and, you know, right out of dental school and all excited and looking forward to everything and not knowing a lot other than what little means they gave you in dental school. And you're set forth in this world to figure out how to get to the finish line. How do you get to retirement? And what happens between the day you start and the day you end? And everyone's path is different. And so that's the same with, you know, becoming a professional racer. There's a lot of things along the way. And so, you know, we don't have all night to talk about this, but so I picked in my lecture a lot of key components, not only for, you know, what to do when you're young and early in your career, to business things you can do throughout your entire career, and also the dental aspect of how to do restorations, both the diagnosis and the placement of these materials utilizing modern technology and devices so that you can have a successful practice and so that people talk about you and help build your brand image and your name. And so my day-long lecture kind of went through all of these different components Granted, we can't touch on a lot of them real long, but there was just a lot of great, what I feel are key elements to get anyone to the finish line or start building on their growth to get there.
Awesome. Well, hey, I want our listeners to kind of think about this as drinking from a fire hose. All right. You've heard that. You've heard that analogy.
I tend to do that quite often in my lectures. Right. I give too much often.
Before we do that, though, it occurred to me that our listeners don't know your background as a racer. Would you take a minute and or as long as you like to talk a little bit about your experience as a race car driver? And when we use that, it literally, you are a race car driver. that isn't a metaphor. That isn't, you know, just a figure of speech. Share with our listeners a little bit about your experience racing.
So I got involved after dental school. Unlike most kids who start off when they're like six or seven in go-karts, I got in a go-kart in my 20s when I finally had a little bit of money in my pocket and an inexpensive way to get into the car and have a lot of fun. Come to find out that you have to go to work on Monday. You can't go flying out of a go-kart down the track and hurt your fingers or your neck.
Oh, yeah. So, by the way, was that a 125 shifter cart?
Yes.
again, I share a common interest with Todd. Perhaps the most fun you can have,
yeah.
You know, I guess with your clothes on, yeah. You know, racing a one of those shifter carts, because your butt is how far off the ground, Todd?
Well, it depends. Anywhere from half an inch to touching, based on what you're going over.
And how fast?
Oh, goodness. They've clocked some at 200 miles an hour, but I would say most are about 120.
Right. And, you know, usually the scale of the courses that you're racing on are scaled to the size of the carts, and it's serious fun.
Yeah, the power-to-weight ratio is just phenomenal. It's second to none as far as power-to-weight ratio.
Yeah, share that. We'll have some engineering-type dentists that would be interested in that. The cart weighs how much? Just ballpark?
Oh, gosh. Good question. I don't know, 60 pounds?
Yeah, I was going to say, you know, yeah. with us in it, you know, it weighs 220, 230.
Yeah, they're not much.
Not much.
It's got a 125cc, you know, off-road dirt bike engine in it that's all bored out and tricked out, and it wow, it goes.
And putting out probably, let's give a horsepower estimate on that. I guess it depends on how it's been tuned, but plenty of horsepower.
Yeah, I'm sure you can Google it real quick. But, you know, it's funny. I was racing with a prosthodontist that he and I both had the interest of driving, and we were at a race, and we watched one guy literally go down the track. He got wheel to wheel, went airborne, and went down the track about 60 feet doing somersaults. And that's when we go, hey, look, you know, we can't ruin ourselves. We got to go to work. Right. And so we started looking at open wheel cars, like Indy cars, but scaled down versions of it where your body was at least inside and you had, you know, roll bars.
Like a 2.0 liter open wheel Ford?
Yeah, like exactly. That. Ford, yeah. Renault, Mazda, all those, they're, you know, a stepping stone into, you know, higher levels of racing. So we did that a little bit and did well.
And that's a trip getting into an open wheel car for the first time. That's so interesting, isn't it?
Definitely. What a rush. And then from there, you know, money plays a big role in racing, where whoever has the most money gets to buy the most modifications and trick out the car and gets to go to all the races because they keep getting it rebuilt. And so we found that, you know, not having as much money as some of these people, it was easier to go into what they called a spec series, where everyone drives the same car and you can't modify it. It was all about driving skill and setting up the car.
There's some really good spec series out there. You know, the Mazda Miata has a spec series that's a great way to really learn car handling. You know, it's not a high horsepower car, so you really have to have some skill moving that thing around the track.
Definitely.
Porsche Boxsters have a really nice spec series. What are some other spec series that you like?
You know, you already hit the two best ones on the head.
I know. Those are my two favorites.
Definitely. And there's so much room to grow upward from those two, which is nice to have that ladder system built in. If you want to go racing at a higher level, that you can work your way up based on your accolades of, you know, each step of the ladder moving forward.
And it's really a skill-based series because the cars are equal.
Yeah.
In terms of, you know, all the cars have equal specification, whether it be motor, brakes, weight. You know, they're literally equal. And so, you know, the guy on the podium, the guy or gal on the podium, you know, was the best driver that day.
Yeah, definitely.
Right.
It couldn't be further from the truth that the money is out of the picture and it's all about your driving skill and technique. And mm-hmm. So people really start to shine when you take the money out of the equation.
Yeah, that's kind of cool. So from there, where'd you go?
You know, we found a country club outside of Las Vegas and Spring Mountain Motorsport mm-hmm. Resort. And so we got into what's known as Radicals. It is the largest production race car on the market. They're built in England. And so basically it's a prototype. So it's still an open cockpit, but the four wheels are covered and you have a rear wing, and then the whole body is kind of conformed around the tires and around the driver so that it's very aerodynamic. And so they call it a prototype. Mm-hmm. And so we got involved with racing these, and in Europe, it's one of the largest race series over there. It's televised, and they've got a lot of different, these racing programs over here in the States that travel around. And so I befriended an IndyCar driver and a couple other guys, and you know, slowly started moving my way further up the ladder. And so this professional IndyCar driver,
down, or down the slippery slope,
however
you want to look at it.
Yeah, that's true. So he got me basically an audition or a lineup with a professional team in the Lamborghini series, which is televised on CBS.
Sweet.
And so he vouched for me and got me a ride. And so I got my pro card through him and this team. And I got to, fortunately, last season, race professionally on television for four different races on, you know, world famous tracks, previous Formula One tracks and or current day IndyCar and NASCAR tracks. So it was incredible.
And what was the model of Lamborghini?
I was driving the Superleggera Gallardo.
Yeah.
So four-wheel drive, 580 horsepower.
Yep.
Pretty amazing car to get to drive and to be on the track with, you know, professional Formula One drivers and other incredible people that you know, probably idolized on TV at one point. It's amazing to be able to be out there. It's unreal.
And that Superleggera is a lighter car. It's lightened quite a bit. Man, how fun. The horsepower to weight ratio on that car is crazy.
Oh, yeah. Don't get me going. Yeah. Hey, so, I'm racing all night.
Yeah. So anyway, I wanted our listeners to know a little bit about your background. We're talking about racing. This isn't just, you know, something that you fantasize about, but you're out on the track doing cool stuff. Hey, let me pick off a couple topics that I know are in your lecture. We have a lot of listeners to the Thriving Dentist Show that are early in their career and kind of getting started. Some even in dental school that are using this podcast to really prepare themselves for life after dental school. What are some tips you'd give to, what are some tips you'd give to your younger self knowing what you know now early in your career?
That is a great question. And I try to impart that in many of my lectures. So the first thing that myself and just about every dental student that I knew, you know, when I was coming out of school, the first thing everyone wanted to do is obviously get out and get a job, and everyone wanted to get more clinical skills and try and get their mastership in AGD, which is a phenomenal undertaking, and it'll help your career dramatically. But I think the one thing we're missing out, both in school and the thought process once we get out, is we never really learned how to run a business, and we never really learned how to interact with patients. I mean, you get interaction there as a student, but you don't really have anyone training you. So the first thing I would tell anybody to do is to go take some, you know, verbal, you know, communication trainings, whether it be a Toastmasters, whether it be a Dale Carnegie training program, something that gets you in front of people so you can speak, you know, fluently and consistently and come up with a thought process instantaneously and not stutter and stumble over your words.
I believe you just caused a few thousand dentists to break out into a cold sweat, Todd. But amplify that. Tell them why that's so important, because it is.
Well, you know, coming out of school, I didn't get that the same as anyone else. And so, you know, reinventing the wheel, so to speak, since I was going down the AGD path, I literally had a mentor tell me, hey, you know, go take the Dale Carnegie training program. I think it was like 6 months of every week of just standing in front of a bunch of people talking.
And your first reaction must have been, there's no way I'm doing that.
Yes, definitely.
I'd rather slam my head in the car door than do that. I mean,
yeah,
but you did it.
Well, you know, and if you look at, you know, public perception, the number one fear is public speaking. The second number one or second fear on the list of the top 10 fears is dying. So yeah, in other words,
that is the truth, by the way, that
it, to publicly speak than to die, which that is crazy, the, but that's the reality.
That's the God's honest truth. That's exactly true. The number one fear is public speaking. People would rather die than speak in public. But, you know, regardless, you might be listening to this saying, well, I just don't have any interest in getting on a podium and speaking. That's not the point. It's all about your ability to communicate with patients.
Exactly.
Todd, would you agree, and we didn't talk about any of this, this is all just kind of extemporaneous, but would you agree that a doctor's communication skills is probably the biggest limiting factor in practice growth. Would you agree with that statement I believe the biggest limiting factor is the doctor and team members' ability to communicate effectively with patients. So when we're talking about public speaking, you don't necessarily mean that everyone has to get up on a podium and start giving courses. The act of learning public speaking is going to help you communicate more effectively with your patients one-on-one.
Well, it's more than that. It's going to help you. Yeah. Regardless of ever wanting to speak from a podium platform like I do, it's going to help you as a business owner to interact not only with your patients, but also with your staff, because you're a business owner. Forget dentistry. You are a CEO of your company, typically, unless you're an employee of someone else. And even if you are an employee of someone else, you still have to interact with other employees and with your patients. So the number one thing that you really should conquer in any business is learning how to speak and get along with others and articulate what it is you're trying to get across. And that's what this program does. And all the students in this class, we're all CEOs, businessmen, salesperson, and that's their craft, is going out and talking to people. And a dentist is no different. If you can't talk to your patient and get them to understand what's happening and why they should move over the care, and you can't motivate your employees to get them to do what they need to do, and you can't train them, then you're going to fail on both ends. So you need to figure out how you're going to interact with all of these people so that you can be a successful business owner.
Yeah, you can have the most profound clinical skills, but if you have no ability to impart that to the patient, you're not going to get to exercise those clinical skills.
Exactly.
And what great, one of the things again, we didn't talk about this, Todd, so I'd be interested in your opinion on this. But one of the things I encourage my young clients to do is for every clinical course they take, I want them to counterbalance that with, a behavioral course of some sort. It could be speaking. It could be a relationship building. It could be Dale Carnegie. There's many different. My friend Ashley Latter in the UK gives great courses on this. So for every clinical course you take, counterbalance that on the other side with something related to the behavioral side, the social sciences, the behavioral side of your craft.
Yeah, I totally agree. I think that'll pay huge dividends. I think anyone looking back on their career would say the same.
Yeah. So what else early in the career? So you're advocating that in addition to taking a deep dive into clinical postgraduate education, also work on developing your, I'm going to call it behavioral skills.
Yeah. Behavior skills, business skills, there's just a lot of things that get missed out, unfortunately, in the dental curriculum that one needs to entertain if they're going to be successful at running a business.
Yeah. Business side as well. You've got to master the business side. I use in my courses, I use a slide early in the course of a three-legged milk stool. So you can envision that, Todd, in your mind, a three-legged milk stool. And I use it as an analogy because I think to be successful in 2016 and beyond, you've got to master three worlds. And the three worlds you have to master is, I'll number them, but they're not numbered in importance. In my opinion, they're equally important. If any one of those legs isn't there in the stool, what happens to the stool? It topples over. Furthermore, if the legs aren't equal or similar length, the stool is going to be unstable. So if you're too one-dimensional in your focus on these three points, your platform is going to be unstable. So number one is you have to do good dentistry. You have to have clinical excellence. It's required. But it's not enough, is my point. Would you agree with that, Todd?
I agree, because it doesn't matter how good your dentistry skill is if you don't have patients in the chair because you couldn't talk to them properly or your team didn't know how to get them into the office. And all of those are derived from you as the business person.
Right. The second leg I call business acumen. And that's a fancy word. What does that mean? I'll describe it real simply. You have to make a profit. You got to figure out how to do good. Now you have to do two things. You have to figure out how to do good dentistry and make a profit doing it. And as if not, you won't keep your doors open. And the number three is you have to master the behavioral sciences. You have to master the people side of dentistry, because the lens through which people see you, the public, your patients, the lens through which they see you is through the lens of your behavioral skills. And it's not the clinic. I mean, how many patients have come up to you when they recognize you at Vons, at the grocery store? Because they'll recognize you at Vons, right?
Of course.
Have you ever had someone come up to you and say, "Dr. Snyder, I just want to thank you. Before I came in to see you, I did not have incisal edge translucency on number 8 and 9, and now I do. Thank you." I'm just curious. How many times has that happened?
Yeah, that's a zero.
And yet, I do want, just for the record, Todd can do gorgeous anterior restorations with impeccable incisal edge translucency. If there was an award at the country fair for incisal edge translucency, you would win it. Okay. But what is the lens that people, and they write reviews, what do they write them about?
You know, it's funny. If you talk to patients, whether it's a review or someone just, let's say, at a cocktail party, and they say, oh, I've got a great dentist. And you ask him, like, what's so great about him? They said that, you know, he's so nice.
Or, right.
You know, they never say he does great dentistry. And if you're hurting the patient, they'll certainly complain about that.
Oh, you bet.
But it's always like, oh, he's just a nice guy. I'm like, well, what does that say about his work? It says nothing. And so if you can, again, master the communication and the behavioral, you know, just by sitting and talking to them, listening, you know, shaking their hand, thanking them for their time, touching them on the elbow. You know, there's a lot of things you can do if you read up on some of the psychology and behavioral things that are out there of how to create a bond with somebody. It doesn't take more than a few minutes to create that bond. And once you have it, it's stone. They will stay with you for a long time.
You know, I saw this happen today in our practice, Todd, if I can take a little detour and share it with you. We had a new patient today, and we have a new patient coordinator, Carly. And Carly kind of is the connection of the patient to the practice, you know, from the first time they come into the practice, and she kind of, you know, kind of shepherds them through the new patient appointment, the new patient experience. And, she gives them a quick tour of the office. She does a quick interview with the patient to kind of understand a little bit about their dental story. You know, everybody has a dental story, except for the three-year-old, you know, that you're giving a happy visit on the chair. Everyone else has a dental story, and it can be a simple story or it can be a complex story. This happened to be an older patient, early 60s, and, you know, Carly's learning about her. And learning about her dental story. And we take photos. We kind of use Frank Spear's system of Frank Spear taking the six digital photos to help the patients see their teeth in a way they've never seen before. And then we take necessary records, necessary radiographs. And then the doctor comes in, Paul comes in to do the exam. And before we start anything, Carly introduces the patient to Paul. And she starts off by sharing something on the personal side, not teeth related. It'll be something like, in this case, I remember it today. I won't use the patient's name, but, you know, she said, doctor, this is our new patient. This is Dr. Nielsen. And, doctor, our new patient, loves to mountain bike. You know, she really enjoys this, something she's discovered rather recently. You and her are going to have to talk about mountain biking. And so that gave Dr. Nielsen something to kind of connect with the patient on. And he spends, you know, a couple minutes just talking to her about mountain biking and how cool it is that, you know, she's getting into the sport later in age and how fun it is. And, you know, and then we talk about the teeth, you know, and it's a different experience, right?
I agree. And, you know, and that's something they don't teach in dental school. And that's where, again, if you can learn this and master this, and, you know, I hear quite often in my lectures where people go, I don't have time to do that. I'm like, if you don't spend that time, you're going to be having to hustle a lot more, and you're probably going to make less than had you build up that rapport and that bond for just those couple extra minutes, pay huge dividends over your entire career for each individual patient.
Can I share a racing metaphor that my driving instructor is James Bondurant. Do you know him?
Yeah, I know of him. I don't know him personally.
It's Bob's grandson.
Too funny.
You know Bob Bondurant, of course.
Yeah. Of course.
Would you mind sharing with our listeners, in case they don't know who Bob Bondra is, would you share who Bob is or was? Is, I guess.
Well, you know, I don't know all his accolades going backwards. I know him more for his training facilities because the Bob Bondra driving school is one of the ones that I've enjoyed, you know, spending time at to get faster and learn more. Right. So he has his driving schools and different places where you can drive open wheel cars and other types of standard, everyday cars on the street and learn how to drive them in various capacities, whether it's professional racing or defensive driving. And so that's how I know Bob. So you probably know him going back into his racing career, but that recedes.
He was a world-renowned racer in the early 60s when race car drivers literally raced every type of vehicle. You know, they weren't specialized. It wasn't just a NASCAR driver or an IndyCar driver. If it had four wheels on it, they raced it. And that was his career. Anyway, his grandson, James, is my driving instructor, and he's a professional drifter.
Oh, wow.
He goes to Japan 5 months of the year and competes in drifting competitions. And by the way, when I say drifter, I don't mean like he's a vagabond, you know, just walking around aimlessly. think Fast and Furious. Okay. Is that the best way to describe drifting?
Definitely. Yeah. Right,
think fast. So he competes in drifting competition. And one of the things he's helping me do is learn how to drift better through the track. And we'll either get, I'll either ride shotgun with him in his car, or we'll be in separate cars connected by microphone, by our helmet mics.
Sure.
And recently we went out on the track, and I'm trying to perfect my, trying to improve, I should say, my drifting skills. And he's given me instructions, and he said, there's one thing I want you to think about, Gary. He said, sometimes to go faster, you have to slow down.
That's right.
Now, at first I was confused, Todd. I don't mind admitting this. I said, no, James, I want to go faster. Well, Gary, sometimes to go faster, you have to slow down. Is that true?
Yeah. Slow in is fast out.
Explain what that means to our listeners that don't know that driving metaphor.
So if you're coming to a corner and you have some type of straightaway afterwards, whether it's 40 feet long or 1,000 feet long, you have a straightaway. And so if you go into that corner and you go in too fast, as you're turning the corner, you're going to be scrubbing speed. And if you went in too fast, you're obviously going to go beyond the corner, and you're going to end up onto that straightaway. And so with the car getting kind of out of position or slightly out of control because you went in too fast and the gravity's trying to pull it off the track, if you try to go back to gas, you can't get to the gas because it'll just put you off the track even more. And so by the time you finally get the car slowed enough around the corner and you get to gas again, you're already partway down that straightaway. Versus had you actually slowed up the car earlier before the corner or just before the center of the corner, you can get back to the gas pedal earlier than had you gone in and carried too much speed. By getting to the pedal earlier, that straightaway just gained a little bit more real estate, so to speak. So if it was 1,000 feet long, it now added on maybe another 5 feet. Now it's 1,005 feet long. So your car's ability to get to a higher rate of speed because it was a longer distance is going to happen. So if you took more or if you slowed down more going into the turn, you're going to be faster down the straightaway at the long end because you had a longer straightaway to get your car going faster.
You explained that brilliantly. Now extend that explanation into the practice. So this is a saying I often use with my clients is that sometimes to go faster, you have to slow down. What does that mean to you in the practice, Todd?
You know, to me, it's always been about the interaction with the patient. So my exam time is gold. And so, I spend a considerable amount of time in just talking to the patient, as we've already spoken of, gaining that rapport, getting, finding common grounds on things, giving them the time to listen to what they've had previously or what they're hoping to achieve, or just talking about their kids. People want to be heard. They want to hear their name used. There's a lot of things you can do by sitting there. So you're spending, granted, probably me personally, I probably spend 5-6 times the amount of time that a normal dentist that I perceive sitting there and doing an exam. And yet that slow, long amount of time, is definitely taken away from production and you're going backwards, you may think, and other people are waiting on you. I build that into the schedule because I know in the long run, I'm going to be way down that straightaway, going a lot faster, doing a lot more than the guy who didn't spend that time.
I see it as, for example, a patient that comes into your practice, perhaps on an emergency situation where, there was a toothache and they come in and you slow down, you help them understand what's going on and you open up a conversation with them about comprehensive care. Now, all the while you also connected with them. They quickly understand that you care about them, that they aren't a number in your practice, but it's a person that you genuinely care about. And all of a sudden, what might have been palliative treatment in an emergency type situation, perhaps it's an extraction, perhaps it's a drain and incise, perhaps we're doing a root canal, can now turn into significant restorative dentistry because of the needs that they have. And it was all because you slowed down and you connected with them and you developed rapport and relationship. And, there's Dr. Reed, Omar Reed taught me many years ago, and I love to credit it. He didn't come up with this. Someone else did, but I learned it from Omar. So I like to give him credit. And he told me that people want to be understood before they understand. Does that make sense?
I agree. Yeah.
And it's too often I see dentists go to they want to tell the patient what's going on before they understand who this person is that they're in front of.
Yeah.
And I think it's a classic, you know, misorder. It's out of sequence. They do have to understand, but they need to feel understood first. Once they feel understood, then they're going to be much more receptive to whatever recommendations you have for them.
Agreed.
So yeah. I love that analogy of slow down, to go faster. I mean, it just has so much relevance in my opinion. Hey, we're going to dive into a bunch of different topics. Do you mind if I glance off to another one?
Go for it.
So you do some really cool things marketing wise. And you know, I'm going to be sarcastic for just a minute. I don't know if my sarcastic tone always comes out, but Todd, one of the kind of unique parts about your practice is that you're the only dentist in your area. So, of course you're successful because you're the only dentist anywhere near, you know, where people live. Right?
Right. You know, with 400 new patients a month and not a dentist for 500 miles, it's, you know, shooting fish in a barrel around here.
This is a true story. I did meet a dentist. I was lecturing in Kansas last year. Honest to goodness, I'm not making this up. He is the only dentist in his county. Yeah. That's kind of like you, right, Todd?
Yes. Yes. I think that he has less patients than me, though. I've got more being in Southern California.
Okay. Now, tongue removed from my cheek. Your area is hyper competitive, as is Phoenix, where we are. But I don't look at it as competitive. I mean, we've got half the adults, you know, half the people in the United States don't have a dentist at all, whether we're talking about Laguna Niguel or Phoenix, Arizona. And so there's huge opportunity. But take a minute and talk a little bit about, you know, the challenge of practicing in Southern California.
Well, you know, I did one of the ADA surveys a couple of years ago and was looking at the doctor to dentist population ratio in Orange County. I can tell you had the worst. I think it was 2014. So when I say that, you know, things are challenging over here and people talk about dentists being on every corner, it's literally like that. I've got a building that I'm in that every suite in this office is pretty much dentist. So next door is a dentist, two doors down is a dentist. Going the other direction, there's a dentist, two doors down is a dentist. It's like just in my building alone, there's six dentists.
Yeah.
And there's some other places where literally there's like hundreds in the building. So yeah, there's a lot of dentists in Orange County. Now, being that said, I think there's a place for every dentist to be able to thrive and survive just based on what it is you're offering. Because let's face it, there's always someone in need of a dentist and there's plenty of us to go around. So when someone gets disenchanted with one, they'll certainly go to another. And I think you need to make sure you've kind of branded or positioned yourself in such a capacity that people relate to the fact that you are different, that you aren't just like everybody else. Now, what that is for each practice, you know, that's up to each person to determine. So for me in Orange County, you know, I loved cosmetic dentistry when I was in school and when I got out, that's you know, what I loved to learn about. And from there, I liked learning about, you know, temporomandibular joint disorders and how to restore the bite and make someone feel good. So looking good and feeling good, who doesn't want that, right?
Wow, sign me up.
Yeah, exactly. So, you know, I figured, okay, if I can brand myself as the guy that does this kind of stuff in my area, and I'm kind of leading edge technology and whatnot, then, you know, people may want to come see me. And so, you know, the same as we have different types of stores out there. We've got the 99 Cent store, we've got Target, Walmart, Nordstrom's, Neiman Marcus, you know, we've got all different levels. Well, dentistry is no different. You have a lot of different perceived levels. And so I said, all right, well, I'm going to try and position myself in a certain capacity that hopefully drives patients to me. And, you know, starting my office from scratch in 2000, and literally in 2001, we saw our first patients. And that's, for some of you that remember, that's when the Twin Towers fell. Mm-hmm. It was a tough time to open a practice from scratch in Southern California, specifically Orange County, and not knowing a soul, because I literally moved to this area and just opened an office from scratch.
So it's tough starting circumstances there for sure. Timing of you know, world events, and new to the area, no connections. You didn't have a bunch of family and friends to come in. You know, you were starting cold.
Yeah. And, you know, you talk about people with, you know, student debt nowadays. Like, yeah, I had some debt, maybe not as much as it is now, but I had some debt. But then my debt was just as big, if not bigger, because not only did I, you know, sign a contract for a 10-year lease and build out the office, you can imagine the expenditure to build an office out with technology. And then to have no patients and have to try and make sure I get enough patients in every month to pay the overhead is huge. Yeah. Way more than a loan repayment monthly fee.
Sure.
So I see it as something that's doable, but I've done it, so I get it. But man, you got to scramble and you got to work hard.
Share some marketing things that you're doing today that have worked well for you and you've seen work for others that our listeners might be able to adapt to them.
Well, you know, marketing's changed a lot in the last 16 years, and there's some great things that one can do on their own or to hire companies. And so the first thing I would say is, you know, we know that everyone is walking around with some type of mobile device, and there's just going to be more and more of these. We know that 87% of people are looking for a dentist or some type of medical procedure on a monthly basis. They are looking up medical types of procedures. And so your first thing that you need to conquer is the internet. You need a responsive website, something that's modern and is compliant with Google's code, because if people on their mobile devices try to get to your site and it doesn't load quickly, they'll move to the next site. So you got to have a website that's responsive, that has good content that people want to look at. And by doing that, that's your first step. Once you have that, then, you know, social media, there's a ton of stuff on social media that you can be doing for free, whether it be, you know, writing blogs and posting blog information on your Facebook, your Twitter, posting photos on your Instagram, making videos on your YouTube. You know, all of these things are free. It's just a matter of your time or hiring a company to do it or having one of your employees do it. You know, personally, I would say, you know, the best content comes from you, but you can delegate that to a lot of your younger employees that love playing on all these, you know, devices and all these different websites and whatnot. You know, give them 20 minutes a day to go put stuff out there for you.
Sure.
And, you know, it's amazing how over time you put the little pebble in the pond and the ripples eventually get out to the sides, and now you have disturbed the entire pond. Well, that's basically what you're doing on the internet. You have so many means in which to do so that is free advertising, free marketing, other than, you know, paying for bandwidth of your Wi-Fi right. Or paying for your monthly website. So I think those are the cheapest and easiest things. And I do all my own marketing. I don't hire agencies to do anything.
Right.
And so it takes a little bit of time, but it's doable. Very, very easy to understand and learn. There's no degree out of school that, you know, sits you down and says, here's what you must do. It's a matter of everyone just learning over time and rolling with what comes out next by Google or someone else.
Can I add to that in the theme of digital marketing? Todd talked about a responsive website, social media. Absolutely agree with both of those. I'm going to add a third one that I know if you had more time, we'd get into it. It would be reviews, online reviews. Yeah. And I want you to master online reviews. There's four review sites that you need to pay attention to. Google, obviously, by far the 5,000 pound pink gorilla in the room. Google, Yelp. Yelp has a strong following. Third, I would say Angie's List has a decent-sized following, and fourth would be Health Grades. There are 249 review sites out there. There might be 250 by the time you listen to this because they're propping up like mushrooms, so that may change. But those are the four that you need to pay attention to today. And you want the majority of your reviews, the lion's share of those reviews, you want them up on Google because that's where it's going to relate most to your search engine ranking and people able to find you. So, and you can nurture reviews. And I want to encourage all of our listeners to be nurturing reviews. And it's one of the best ways to, even in a very competitive area like Orange County, it's one of the best ways to get on page one of a Google search by having many Google reviews. It won't guarantee you a spot there, but it's part of the algorithm for sure. And I think you've had a lot of success with that, Todd. And the nicest thing about reviews is that it's the voice of the patient. You know, Todd, the patient can say things about you that you simply cannot say about yourself. I mean, you can't. It's not in your nature. It's not in your humility. You can't do it. But when the patient says, oh my gosh, my dentist, Dr. Todd Snyder, is amazing. You know, they can say that, right?
Yeah, no, it's wonderful. It's fun to read those. You get such a kick out of seeing what people are saying about you, and it really makes you feel good about your profession and what you're offering your patients that they felt, you know, to write these wonderful words for you. So, yeah.
A side comment about the reviews, when your team members get called out, and many times they do, it could be Kelly, the hygienist. Doctor, a fun thing for you to do is to read those in your morning huddle as a way to give the team some compliments, and obviously make sure to share the love, because I'm sure at one time or another, all your team members are going to get called out, or I hope they are. But read those and let everyone know and watch what happens to the culture in your practice and the team building that happens as a result of that, because of the fact that they're being recognized. And it's just incredible. Hey, I want to, one more kind of topic area. I know from racing and you know from your experience how important it is to be efficient in the car. When you're in the car, you can't be all over the place, you know, but you have to be very efficient. You have to be very, your intent has to be very high. You've got to be very focused. Talk about how you apply what you know in the race car to what needs to be applied in the practice with efficiency, focus, and intent.
Yeah. You know, obviously racing car is not a, you know, a single person sport. You've got a team behind you. And so you've got all the mechanics, the guys with the fuel rig, you've got people on the radio telling you what to do, and you're just one little cog in a giant engine. You happen to be behind the wheel, but it's the whole team that make you win or lose. And so the dental office is no different. You know, as the dentist and the head of the company, you have everyone else helping you perform. And so I'll give you an example. You know, I was in one of my races, I had a text message or email come across from one of my staff members, because I was obviously out of the track. And there was a patient that was upset about something. And so, you know, me trying to stay in my zone, it was amazing how that one particular race in the car, I just couldn't shake thinking about what we could do to help. And so I'm sitting there behind this wheel going like 150 miles an hour, coming up to a corner, and I blew the corner. And then you're thinking about that corner and the patient, and then you're blowing the next one. And now all of a sudden people are going by you. And so you have to be very efficient and effective and keep your head in the game. Your team members need to do the same. So, you know, me going around this track going, okay, I can never do this again. I can't think about business and try and be efficient doing this. So in the practice, it relates to the fact that, you know, things will happen to pull you off your game. It'll happen to your employees as well.
And perhaps multiple times a day.
Yeah.
It goes with the turf.
Yeah.
You know, and it could be a team member that inadvertently is tugging at your elbow at a time that's, you know, not the timing. The timing is not right. Could be a patient that throws you a curveball. And I think one of the things that our listeners can do is just expect it. You know, don't be surprised when that happens.
and they happen all the time. And that's just dentistry. That's the way it is. And it's the way it's always going to be. I'm a perfectionist and I take it to heart, unfortunately, too quickly, where I need to let it go more. Where you're trying to accomplish everything and be everything and you can't. You know, sometimes you have to let it go. We were just doing a webinar earlier tonight and we literally had 3 minutes to get my microphone working and it wasn't working. And the guy on the other end was stressing and carrying on. I'm like, look, just calm down. We're going to work with this. We're going to make it happen. And sure enough, 3 minutes later, mic was running. We were up.
But
one of those things where, you know, in your mind, you're going, oh my God, it's not going to work. It's like, no, it will work. Just relax, let it go. All things will come together.
But notice that. I want to use that as an example. We didn't talk about this, Todd, but I want to use that as an example. So the guy on the other end of the mic is stressed out.
Oh, yeah.
And if you're not careful, how does that affect you? You know, if you're not focused, you're going to essentially transfer. They're going to transfer that stress to you. Same with the patient. If you're, with a patient and you're, you know, visibly out of sorts, you know, you're just, things aren't right. The material that's on the tray isn't right. Whatever happened, it's not right. Then how does that, you know, how do you recover from that? You're spinning, you know, it's like, I don't mind admitting this, but, last time I was out on the track with James Bondurant, I was more effective at spinning my car than drifting it. don't tell anyone that, Todd.
You know what? Spinning is a good thing because it teaches you car control and teaches the limits versus if you were too scared to get to that limit, you'll never know what it's like when you get there. So it's better to push beyond and then dial it back. So
yeah,
good job.
My nickname on that track that day is the spinning top. and something about the engine in the rear of the car makes it spin really good.
Oh, yeah.
But anyway, I was a more effective spinner that day than a drifter.
Yeah. So, you know, so here in the practice, you know, the same thing. You know, something's going to pull you off your game. It's going to get in your mind. And then you're going to walk to the next patient or the next staff member and blow it. No. So you got to really keep this in the back of your mind going, look, problems are going to happen today. I can handle it. We'll figure out a way to manage it. Just keep a smile on your face, keep everything moving forward, and get back on your game as quick as possible so that you can stay, you know, in your zone and be effective. Because if you pull yourself out, now you're pulling the other part of the team out. And so, you know, really it's a trickle down effect. If you're doing it to other people because it happened to you, now everyone's got a bad day.
Don't kick the dog.
You got it.
And hey, so, hey, Todd, let's finish with a fun little discussion about a mutual friend of ours. I think you feel the same way about Dan Fisher that I do. I've had Dan on the show a couple of different times, and what a great guy. You give a number of courses each year hosted by UltraDent, among others. But how do you feel about Dan?
Dan's an amazing person. He's done so much for dentistry, but so much for just people around the world, helping them to a better place. He's a wonderful soul.
Yeah, well said. Todd, share with our listeners a little bit about how they can connect with you. If you wouldn't mind sharing your website, we'll put it in the show notes so they can connect with you. How can we direct them if they want to learn more about you and what you're doing and maybe get on a racetrack together? That'd be kind of fun, huh?
Yeah, definitely. All right. So I have numerous websites. Again, I do so much marketing, have so many endeavors and companies outside of the dental aspect. So the dental one, since it's dentists listening to this, is drtodd Snyder, snyder.com. So it's drtoddsnyder.com.
Perfect. If you're listening, don't take your hands off the wheel. That's not safe. I will put those, the links in the show notes. You can go to Takas, T-A-K-A-C-S, learningcenter.com, and all the links will be in the show notes. Todd, would you mind if our listeners reached out to you via email and connected with you? Would you mind sharing your email address?
Yeah, I was going to add that too. So it's DOC, as in doc, at tcsdental.com. And so again, DOC, doc, at T, as in Todd, C as in cat, S as in Sam, dental.com.
Hey, you know, I know you do some fun things that combine, you know, another thing we have in common is we do things that combine our passions. So I do Ride and Learn, where we take dentists on Harley Davidson motorcycle tours, and we combine Harley motorcycle tour with serious dental continue education. I've called it Race and Learn, where we go out, we do this at racetracks around the country, and we combine serious dental CE with high performance driving. It's not racing in the sense of wheel to wheel, but it's with high performance driving. And you do some fun stuff too.
You know, I do a very similar program thanks to UltraDent. And so maybe you and I can do one in the future.
You bet.
But yeah, you know, UltraDent was kind enough to help bring one of my ideas to light. You know, I sat in CE courses the same as everyone else, and I said, let's do something different. And so we were doing a lecture and hands-on, as well as going out and driving, in one case was exotic race cars and or street high-performance cars. And in this coming year, I think we're going to do 5 or 6 programs around the country where we'll either tie in go-kart racing or some type of, you know, driving school type setup. So really looking forward to that being put on by them.
How about if we do this, Todd, just for fun? I want to blow up your server. If you're interested in joining Todd hey, I'm going to accept your invitation, Todd and I, if you're interested in joining us out at one of those things, send Todd an email. So again, it's doc, D-O-C, at tcsdental.com. Send Todd an email, and just in the subject line, just put cars. C-A-R-S. Okay. Just put cars. You don't have, and if you want to write a note, go ahead and write him a note. You know, you can thank him or you can write him a note if you want to. If not, just put cars in the subject line. And I'm going to see if I can blow up your server, Todd.
Okay. So thank you for that. Appreciate it. I was going to say, let's take it a bit further. Let's, you know, social media. Obviously you and I are friends on social media. I would love to see a bunch of, you know, gearhead dentists all join me on Facebook. You know, I've got numerous different ones on there, whether it's Todd Snyder or Todd Snyder Racing, you know, because that's where I share a lot of free information and exchange of ideas and talking about upcoming programs that you and I will be doing.
How about if I put both of your, I'll put, you know, your both of your Facebook accounts, you know, Todd Snyder and Racing, I'll put both of those links in the show notes as well so that our listeners can jump in that forum and use that as a communication tool as well. Does that sound all right?
That sounds fabulous.
Cool. Hey, Todd, I want to take a minute and say thanks. You know, one of the things I absolutely love about you is the passion that you bring to taking care of your patients. You know, it's clear, you know, for our listeners, you spend 5 seconds with Todd and you understand that he's passionate about helping people have great oral health and gorgeous smiles. And it shows. And by the way, it's a great pathway. You know, T-Bone was right. Dentistry can provide absolutely everything you want. And, you know, I think one of the thoughts I'd like to leave our listeners with is a quote I heard recently, and it was the quote that I'm trying to think of who I can credit the quote for. I don't remember the source, but it was, the mistake that many people make is not that they set their goals too high, but they set them too low and achieve them.
That's a good one. I like that. You know, I'll throw one in there as well. And if your dreams don't scare you, they're not big enough. You know who that one is?
You know, I want to say Mario Andretti, but I he has a one similar to that. But
does he? I got to look that one up. So that was Muhammad Ali.
Muhammad Ali. Okay, perfect. And that's timely, of course, with the sadly the loss of that great human. But yeah, you know, I love that. So repeat that again, just for our listeners' benefit.
If your dreams don't scare you, they're not big enough.
Love it. Love it. Hey, Todd,
that's me opening an office.
Hey, thanks for all that you do. Thanks for your passion. Thanks for taking some time to share your wisdom and passion with our listeners. Also want to take a minute and thank our listeners. You know, we love what we do here at the Thriving Dentist Show, but you know, we couldn't do what we do if it wasn't for you. Of course, the show's free, but there's 3 ways you can support us. You can, number one, tell a colleague about the podcast. There's many dentists that have never heard the word podcast. Ask them to pull their phone out and show them how to download the Thriving Dentist Show. Secondly, you can jump on iTunes and write us a review. If you go to iTunes and you hit the podcast tab, type in Thriving Dentist Show, and you'll see where you can write a review. That helps us. That's similar to you getting a review on Google. That has the same value for us in the podcast world. Third thing that you can do is simply subscribe. You know, you can subscribe on iTunes, you can subscribe on Google Play, whatever your podcast directory of choice is, hit the subscribe button. That means every Wednesday, a new show will be uploaded to your listening device and you'll never miss a show. On that note, let me simply say thank you and tell you I look forward to connecting with you on the next Thriving Dentist Show.
When you cry, be sure to dry your eyes, 'cause better days are sure to come. And when you smile, be sure to smile wide, and don't let them know that they have won. And when you walk, walk with pride, don't show the hurt inside, because the pain will soon be gone. When you dream, dream big, as big as the ocean blue. When you dream, it might come true. When you dream, dream big.